Hello, welcome back to the Off-Grid Family. Before we start, I'd like to tell you that this was a major fail video. Now, I ummed and ahed about putting it online, and I thought to myself, some of my fail videos have nuggets of greatness in them, and I like to be as transparent as I can and show you all my messes up as well as all my, you know, victories. And I do feel this one's got quite a lot of information in it that will be helpful to people. The main thing I liked about this project was the lighting, but that's fine. But I think I made the mistake right from the beginning. And what I did was I took an item and tried to build my designs around that rather than build my designs and have a look to see what I had. So you'll see me showing you a little bit of an easel. And because of that, I just designed around that. And that's where most of my errors came. One thing would go wrong with it, so I'd try and build something around that, and so on and so on. I just kept trying to fix a problem that wouldn't be there had I not chosen to use that item. So my advice whenever building a new design is don't take what you've got and build around that. Take your design and see what you've got that will go well with your original design. This isn't the only video I'll do on a lighting rig and a camera rig. I still want one. I think I'm going to make it separate, so I think I'm going to work solely on making a lighting rig in the next couple of weeks and then make a camera rig after that. Anyway, you crack on watching this, and then at the end I'll tell you all the major problems with it. Basically, it just abruptly stopped, and that's where I just got to the point where it was like, what am I doing? I'm trying so hard to fix this object. And the more I try and fix it, the further away it gets from what it was going to be. Enjoy what you watch. And I'll be back at the end to tell you what went wrong and so on. Today I'm going to be doing a video. I'm not sure how comprehensive it will be, but I'm going to do a video on making a camera and lighting rig. Now, I'm just using what parts I have lying around. I'm not paying any money for anything. Itch my eye. I'm just going to use what I've got lying around. Now, one thing I have that will be helpful that you guys probably don't is I have an old bit of an easel. And I thought it might be perfect because, let me unscrew it a sec, it'll allow me to have movement that way. Now, I'm literally just going into my junk drawer and I'm getting bits of wood. I'm going to cut them down to different sizes and I'm just going to let you see along the way what I'm doing. I don't expect you to be able to copy this exactly, but it might allow you to, you know, find your own bits that you can use. I've wanted a camera and lighting rig for ages. I actually used some 12 volt lights that I did a review on, which I'll put a little doer up there. And I use them for my lights, you know, and they're absolutely fine. They work okay, but they're not like, I want them to be more like spotlights so I can have proper good contrast on if I'm doing electronics. And also I want a bit more movement of my camera because it's either on a tripod or in my hand, and that's the sort of two ways it can be. So I'll just get on. I will talk you through bits if I feel it's necessary, but I'll show you the process as I do it, and hopefully it'll just give you some ideas about what you could do if you decide you want to make one too. Let's get on then. It's been about 2 days holding this thing, trying to decide whether I wanted it this way so it could scoot up along and backwards and forwards like this. I finally decided to have it this way. And have it so that it's sort of like a crane. What I'll do is I'll lay out the way I've sort of decided to do it on a table, because I've got to a point now where I need to start connecting it all to see if it all fits and, you know, that kind of thing. I've got to a point now where I need to connect it all together, well, bits that I've made, make sure it all works how I have in my head, because I was going to draw a plan, but there was no point. It's all little bits that go to other little bits. So I'm just gonna, normally I'd build it as I go along, but I haven't had a chance to record, so I thought I'd do all that at the same time. Okay, if we imagine that this is this way around, this bit will be connected to my desk on a swivel so it can turn freely, if, you know, like that. But I've now got all these little blinking pieces to go on. So, I'm going to have these connected to here, like this. And this will be connected via a screw here, and here, here, and here. And then this will have the camera on it. And it will, the whole thing will be able to move to any, you know, any sort of angle and direction. Because we'll have the weight of the camera on this end, and we're going to have some lights here, I needed to make a secondary support. So what I thought was, if I have another doohickey in here, let me move you closer now. If I have this in here, screwed again, with a support structure that goes along here, and then this will all be screwed, but tightenable and loosenable up, so we've got a lot more strength in this arm here. I've also made sort of, this will be the base that the whole thing sits on, and various other bits. This will be part of a lighting rig that I need to work out a bit more. But this is as far as I've got, but it obviously doesn't look like much. So what I'll do is I'll put it all together and then I'll give you a bit of a demonstration. But I just thought I'd show you that at the moment, we are literally at this stage where it's just lots of little bits all cut out and, you know, none of it looks like it should work, but we'll see. So I'll be back once I've got it all put together. Okay, when I last saw you, it was just this this on its own with lots of bits. Now we have a swing arm on it. The camera will screw into here, and then it will have all different ranges of movement on top as well, depending on what thing I'm, you know, recording. So we've got that bit set up. Now, as I said, I'm going to need a support beam of some kind to make it so that all the weight down here doesn't just slowly pull it down like that. I came up with this. So let me unscrew this a sec. Actually, this side. Oh. Now this will go in here. Actually, I'll give you a close-up of it, all these separate as well. So that is just that, and all it is a few screwed on pieces. If you have a look at it that way, they're just screwed in, and I've used quick release nuts on them so I can tighten it up as needed. It's quite stiff anyway, so it does hold it. And I've put washers between each piece of wood to give it more range of movement. And as I say, it's quite stiff, so it does hold its shape there, but it just means I can tighten it up if needs be, if I want to keep it in a certain position where it's too heavy. The support is just another little arm, and screws in there like that, and then we've got a screw here that gets screwed in, and we can then tighten this as well and change its angle depending on what we need. I'll connect that now. And then, as I say, this screw here is pointing downwards, so that it can go straight through the gap. And then again, a washer. Like that. So now that holds it tight if you tighten everything up, obviously. Tighten it all up properly, and then that just gives it another form of protection at the moment, because this hasn't got the washer on, it's still quite loose. Now, in fact, if I put the washer on quickly and I'll be back, hang on. Okay, I need a bigger washer on this piece here, it keeps slipping slightly. But there we go, that's like that. Now the next thing I've made is just the most simple thing so far. This is where the lights are gonna be attached. I'm gonna have lights that attach either side here and here, that face downwards, and then they can be angled depending on where the light's needed. Put that down. All I did for this was cut a piece of wood that is the same width as the actual gap in this bit here. And so this bit just slips in like that, and it allows for backwards and forwards movement and side to side. Let me screw that in, and I'll give you a close up of the whole lot working together. So far, we've got the support that holds this all together. We've got the actual arm that holds the actual camera. And then we've got our lighting arm here, which I've got to make the lights for in a minute. But this allows for movement either way and left and right. And they'll be facing downwards so that they're... I'm not sure if I'm going to angle them downwards as well. I'm not 100% sure what I'm doing there. But that'll be my next job, to work out what I'm doing about the lights. Oh, one other thing. At the back here, no matter how much support I put on, if I keep adding white to this end, especially say if I need the lights up right up this end and the camera at its longest, especially if I need it all the way out like that, for example, I don't think I will, but no matter how much support I put on, this will pull it down. So what I'm going to do to counteract that is I'm going to make a counterweight that comes off here, and it's actually going to have another set of lights. So I'm going to have four different sets of lights, and hopefully that will be enough to counterbalance the weight of it trying to pull itself down. As I say, when it's tight enough, it will hold its weight quite well, but I haven't done any of the things that are tight enough really. Right, I've got these old placemats. We've got loads of different ones, but they've all got stains on them and they all need to be repurposed. And they'd be the perfect size for the lighting. So I'm using LED strips. So what I need to do is I need to take them and just spray paint them, not for any reflective reasons or anything, but just so that they don't look like that. I don't want anything distracting me while I'm trying to do my videos. So, I'll spray paint them and get back to you. Okay, they're spray painted. I had wanted them white, but the white just wouldn't stay on them for some reason, and I end up leaving nice fingerprints on them. So, I'm gonna now attach the LED strips and do all the wiring for you, so that's our next job. Okay, when you buy these LEDs, they're often in strips. Now you can get these relatively cheap from China and they tend to work quite well. I've got two strips of them up in my kitchen, and one's right above where the kettle is, and so three of them have been steamed for about a year, and then they stopped working, but other than that all of the rest of them work absolutely fine. You can get them really cheap. I bought three rolls of 5 meters, and I got them for, it was less than £2 a roll anyway, it was about £1.70 I think a roll. Now with these rolls, they come with little dots every third LED, as you can see there, and that's because they're set in sets of three. So if you cut it here and here, you can still connect that up to a 12 volt battery and that would work, right? But if you cut halfway between them, then you've cut out the wrong bit and it won't work. So as long as you cut on the across this line between the holes, they will work. So I could cut it off there and I could connect this to a 12 volt battery and it would work. Right, another thing you've got to know about these cheap ones is, not on the more expensive ones, but the cheaper ones tend to have it. Halfway down you will see a set of two solder points, and if you roll along again there'll be another set of two solder points. Now this is where shorter pieces have been soldered together to make it longer. Now, luckily enough, I knew this before I started, and what I did, I took the mat I was going to be using, or the piece of wood now, I measured it out, and then I made it so it was directly halfway along. So if you fold that up, so all I need to do is desolder this and cut it in half. Okay, I'm just warning you, you can go longer, you can go as long or as short as you want, but what I'm saying is, with my version, with the way I'm doing it, it just means I can fold this like this, fold it like this, cut it there, and then just desolder those two points, and I've got my strip. So I'll do that now. So measure it against. And what I'm going to do first off is I'm just going to cut it here, just for this occasion. So I want to show you how to deal with it. Now, if like me, you've made it so that it's at this solder point, the easiest way to sort this out, get your soldering iron on and heating up, turn it over, and the sticky pad on the back is often raised slightly away from the actual place where the solder point is. And all you need to do
shove your scissors in there, or I found wire cutters, you know, wire tin snippers and stuff are better because they've got a sharper point. But you just stick it in and cut it as close to where the soldered joints are as you can. Now, moving this out of the way because we don't need it at the moment. Okay, now holding either side of the joint and giving it a little bit of pressure, just touch your soldering iron to each piece and it will slowly want to come apart. There you go. Now what you've got to do is you've got to cut as many pieces as you'd like for your project. I'm doing 4 of those mats like this, so and I've got 13 rows, so I need 4 times 13, but I've already done 1, which is actually what's giving us the light for this project at the moment. So I have cut a few, I will count them and see how many more I need. Each one of these copper little dots is a contact, so you do not want to cut through them. So if you can, cut to the side of each, not necessarily going through the line, but leave in enough contact on each piece to be able to solder to. And I cut all the ones I need to the right size now, and then I'll be back. Okay, now because I'm making 4, it's full of repetitive tasks. The next thing we have to do is on each end of these is solder on a nice blob of solder on each of the contacts. So as you can see, the copper contacts here and here need to be soldered on. Some of them will actually have copper, will have solder on them, but I always like to add a little bit more than that. Now when you're doing this, as I say, try not to melt the plastic. It is quite easy, don't have your soldering iron up too high and just don't take too long doing it. I'll prep that, get that ready, and we'll record from there. Okay, like with any soldering, you have to heat the pads as well as the solder. But you don't want to heat the pads too long, and I'm doing this a bit awkwardly to show you on camera, so I'm hopefully going to get it right. But heat the pad and then immediately bring the solder down to it. Like that. I've got the... Let me move that a sec. Okay, and then the second one, these handy helpers that I'm using to record are too vicious and they're actually biting through it, but I'm just doing this to show you. Okay, heat the pad, then the solder, straight on. Okay, so I've got to do that another 26 times for this lot. So as I say, do both ends, making sure to get a decent amount on. Even if they've had solder on, I'd re-solder them. That's done on all of them. The next task, which again, if you don't like repetitive tasks, then you're not going to enjoy yourself. We have to do something like this. This is the ones it comes with. But what we need to do is we need to connect a black and a red lead to this end at the corresponding points. And then we're going to put a little dab of glue on it. It doesn't have to be any more than an inch, I would say. About that. That's absolutely ample. Now we need 39 of them. That's fun. Now, you need to do a small split up the end of each. Again, seriously, if you don't want like repetitive tasks, please do not do this. Now, as you use LEDs, well, strip LEDs yourself, you will find faster ways of doing this and better ways and so on. So if you want to do a different way, by all means do it. This is just the way I'm doing it. Also, you don't need black and red. If you haven't got any, use any colours you like. It's just purely to make it a bit easier on yourself. Okay, now we've done that, another repetitive task. We need to strip all of the tips of them. You literally only need to strip off a tiny bit on each. Okay, another boring job, but while I'm doing these things, I listen to audiobooks. That's why it often goes silent, because I'm not paid by anyone to tell you and show you, so that's not something I will do. Although if Audible want to get in touch and give me a free membership, I love audiobooks. Hint, hint. Right. Next boring, monotonous job is to tin the ends of these. That just means get a bit of solder on the end of each one. Tin the ends of one of these, it's very simple. Just heat the end of where you want to tin, touch it and the end with your, touch the solder and the end of the thing you're tinning, and job done. It's that quick. So I've got to do that to all of them now. Okay, that took absolutely ages, but it's done now. The next thing is to place your strips on your workbench and find something to put on top of them. And now, with your soldering iron, making sure you've got the right sides, the right colours to the right sides. Now, they'll have a plus and a minus in certain places. Just there, plus and a minus. So, red to plus, black to minus. Start off by just getting one on there. Place your soldering iron on both the solder and the wire and hold it there. For the first second, it won't have stuck to the pad. And if you pull it, the whole lot will move. Now, same thing with the black. Bend it into place, hold both, and hold down. And there we go, that's done. Now, being very careful, because at the moment that's quite loose, swap it over and do the other end. Now, as you can see on this one, it doesn't have a plus and minus, but if you move along, you'll be able to see it somewhere else. So just find where it is and stick the colour to the corresponding pad. Okay, so I've done all of them. I started to glue some of them and I got bored. So I've only done a few and I'm just going to work around that for now and I'll come up with another plan. But the next bit is we've got to mark out our piece of wood, which I've already done. I've done lines about a centimetre and a half apart. It doesn't really matter, you know, I'm not really too bothered as long as they're sort of in the straight line. Now, another thing I was thinking of doing was glue gunning them down and then sticking them, because the sticky is never very good on these. But I did it with the prototype, the first one, and it looked terrible. It was really, really bumpy and lumpy and horrible. It took absolutely ages. So I'm not going to bother doing that. I'm just going to stick them directly down onto this and hope they stay. Sometimes they are fine, sometimes they're not, as I said. So this hasn't been put on very well, as you'll be able to see by the lumps in it. So we'll just have to see how it goes. Now, one thing I need to point out, let me get a couple. Make sure they are all up the same way. Now, on them, they have writing. And as long as you make sure that all the writing's up the same way, it'll mean the wiring is a lot more simple. So, off we go. Basically, it's just a case of peeling off the back. Only a little bit, not all of it. Finding your line, sticking it on, and then just slowly pull the piece that you've peeled off away and stick it down behind it. Doing it this way, it just means you won't get you will still get lumpy bits because of the sticky stuff isn't correct, but it should cut down on the amount of lumps. Again, just make sure it's the right way up. I just keep them the way that's orientated to me up, and that just seems the easiest way. As I say, these won't be dead on the right, you know, dead straight. But as long as they're sort of straight, Now, I ummed and ahed when I was doing this to whether to connect them to a piece of wood first so that it would be easier for me to actually connect the whole board up to my lighting rig. But I decided I will just get that when I come to it, because I'm not entirely sure, and I didn't want to put like a batten of wood up through the middle and be constantly fighting against a wobbling piece of wood. And although there's lots of ways around that, I just didn't want to. Okay, there we go. Now, if you've done it as I've said and kept all of the pieces up the same way, then the next bit of wiring is easy. If you haven't, it's a little bit more time consuming if you have to actually think about it, but it's still not rocket science. I'll show you that bit now. But first, I'm going to get a blob of glue and I'm going to put it all down these connections. Number one, to hold these on a bit better, and number two, to make sure that the wires don't come off when I'm fiddling. Okay, at this point you want your soldering iron again. If you don't have one, you can just twist all these wires that I'm going to show you together, but I prefer to solder it all. Now you're going to want to start off by getting one of the positive of the first LED strip on one side facing you, and the negative of the other end facing you. And then what you need to start doing is pairing the colours all the way down. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to solder them all in their correct alignment, and then I will talk you through how it's done. Okay, as you can see, I've left the red, and then I've connected the black, the red, black, red, black, red, all the way along, and then it leaves a black at that end. And on the other side is exactly the same, except to start with the red and end with the black. Now what you're left with is four wires, two red and two black. And the thing about this is you can connect it this way. So red to black, which will light them up. Can you even see that in this light? Right, let me change over the lighting. They're quite low because of the battery I'm using is quite dead. Doesn't have a lot of power. But there's one, so that's connected to the red this side and the black this side. But I can actually move it over. So the red's still connected. Let me move that around. Red's still connected in that corner. And what we're going to do is connect in this corner. Okay, so it doesn't matter which side you use, as long as red's to positive and black's to negative. One thing I'd like to warn you about before we go any further. Let's bend these down. Oh, that one's come apart. Do not tin both ends of your wires. Tin the ends that you're going to connect to here. Do not tin this end. If I had not tinned this end, I could have twisted them all together and soldered them in a matter of 30 or 40 seconds, whereas this took me about 10 minutes to do because I was having to connect them and solder them. So, as I say, do not tin both ends. I will put a little warning at the, you know, at the relevant part to tell you guys that, but only tin the ends of the wires that you're connecting to the LED strips. Okay, so this is where we are at the moment. Let me move you up. I've just clamped it straight to the windowsill at the moment, but we've got rotation, then we've got movement of the actual camera. It's not too bad. There is a slight wobbling problem if you let go like that, but I am thinking of actually putting another support from here up to here, because once I have the lights on, it's going to be heavier and so on. That might stop the wobbling, but it may not. But it's quite nice, you know, we've got quite a good movement. Anyway, back to it. And first lighting test, 3, 2, 1.
Okay, so as you'll see from the footage, the very last thing, the lighting test, lights work perfectly, and although the camera mount would swing the camera around all beautiful and everything, it just shook, would just vibrate like that, and you'd have to wait a good 10 minutes, and every time I sort of tried to stop it, I'd hold it, and then I'd sort of let go just ever so gently, and that'd be enough to start it just vibrating. And sometimes I wouldn't notice it was vibrating until I was editing afterwards, so it just had to go, I couldn't do that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start literally from scratch, apart from the lights, and I'm going to show you how to do an actual lighting circuit that will go with that, so you can turn various ones on. I might make a dimmer, I might not, I'm not sure. And I'm thinking about making them waterproof, like 100% waterproof, because I want to actually do some outdoor videos, and they'll be at night, and I'm obviously going to need some lighting of some kind. But thanks for watching. You know, if you enjoyed what you watched, even though it was a failure, you know, please give me a thumbs up. Subscribe if you haven't already. And if you've got any ideas of what you'd like to see in the future, please leave me a message. Thanks for watching. See you again soon. Bye.